Everything about the Bayswater Power Project near Muswellbrook is big. This juggernaut represents a marriage of Japanese and Italian technology. Tsuba of Japan has built this statue, which will go into Bayswater No. 2, as well as much more of the machinery now sitting on the dock. The statue was offloaded from the Waikaumi Maru this morning, and workmen spent the day positioning its 280 tonnes on specially built rail carriage. That carriage was manufactured by Kometo in Japan and is one of the largest in the world. It has 24 axles and will be used for the next 20 years to transport machinery needed at Bayswater. This is the first 660 megawatt generator that Elcom have had to move by land and is a special challenge. What is normally a 4-hour trip will take at least 10 hours, crawling at 25 kilometres an hour and stopping at sidings to avoid faster trains. The monster leaves at midnight Saturday.
Good afternoon. Well, this is a big event coming up for the Newcastle Anglers Association. They're hosts to the New South Wales Division, and the big titles are on this weekend, held from Belmont. That's the 16-foot sailing club, and it's a beach and rock event only. The conditions are, well, I would call almost perfect. The light offshore breezes, not a big swell at all, should be really good. You'll see some top catches. The weigh-in is tomorrow at 10 o'clock at the Belmont 16-foot sailing club. And if you want to see some top catches of fish from guys from all up the north coast and south coast, be there, because it'll be a terrific weigh-in. And there have been some very good catches of tailor on Stockton Beach. Stockton Beach would be a good go tonight too, I should imagine. You have a dark moon out, or a new moon. That's no moon at all. And the conditions on the rocks, well, as I said earlier, really, really good. You'll find potholing could be the go. It's, let's see, a high tide about midday, or midnight that is. Low water in the afternoon, so you'll get a making tide all night. There will be guys out fishing, I'd say, all night tonight to try and take this big championship off. It's been very well organised by the Belmont 16-foot fishing club, and credit goes to them for their organisation as well as the Newcastle district itself. But getting back to the fishing, outside fishing's been excellent. Johnny Morris scored a heap of big snapper in close to Newcastle. That's just out through the heads. And he was saying that there was also some big tailor in amongst the floating baits that he had out as well. Also, I believe the bluefin tuna are fairly thick outside and have been for the last week or so. They've been in fairly deep water, out around about 2 or 3 miles south of the channel itself. So if you wanted to have a go for the finnies tomorrow, might be a good go. That's about it. Good luck and all the best to the guys in the competition. Good afternoon.
The accident happened at about 1:45 this afternoon near the Freeman's Park camping site. Police say two 19-year-old men from Epping in Sydney were riding a 250cc Yamaha racing bike the wrong way down a one-way road when they collided with a high-ace van travelling in the opposite direction. Ambulance and police officers were quickly on the scene and paramedics were flown in by rescue helicopter from Newcastle. Both men sustained extensive injuries in the accident, with the rider suffering a fractured skull as well as internal and chest injuries, while his pillion passenger's injuries are still being assessed at Belmont Hospital. The rider was transported to Royal Newcastle Hospital by the rescue chopper and is reported to be in a serious condition.
When the Westpac crew departed its temporary base at the International Sports Centre today, it was with few, if any, regrets. According to the crew, the old base, which consisted of a space to land, a toilet block and two disused ticket boxes, was far from adequate. It was with pleasure that the crew cleared out the ticket box storerooms for the last time, in preparation for the short flight to the new base near Broadmeadows District Park. Getting a permanent base has not been easy for the Westpac crew. Today's move follows a three-year battle with the Newcastle City Council. Late last year, the council approved the district park base for a trial period of 18 months, but the crew hopes it won't be asked to move again when the trial period is up. For the crewmen, the new base with its adequate storage space, showering and changing facilities and telephone is something of a luxury. It's a luxury, however, that after waiting 8 years for, they don't want to lose.
The decision was reached today at a meeting of shearers in Dubbo. They voted 820 to 266 to end the strike, but they will only use the narrow shearing combs when they return to work. The shearers are taking a harder line on the issue than their counterparts in Victoria, Tasmania and South Australia. Other states have decided to return to work under the award in exchange for a full inquiry. New South Wales rejected the move last week, and their stand on the matter now could affect the Commission's investigation.
David received the award for the best cameraman from a regional television station for his taping of the hold-up of the Derby Street chemist shop, and he also received a commendation for his portrayal of the Allendale nurses' strike. David came straight from school to work as a film editor at NBN and has been a news cameraman for 5 years.
The whole NBN team, they're a great bunch of people to work with, and thanks to my wife, I better throw that in, for putting up with all the late arrivals for news stories. Thanks very much. Thank you.
Here are some excerpts from the award-winning reports.
We were near where the hold-up occurred and saw someone carrying what appeared to be a gun. The man backed up and gave chase. I suggested the news crew get ready to duck and saw that he got into a cab. We were able to wave to a policeman on a motorbike who gave chase and in a matter of minutes it was all over.
Stand by the duck.
These people are only second-class citizens, but they have done their duty for years, and it's a shame to see them the way they are. Thank you.
Many patients have had to be taken to other hospitals, and some have been taken home by relatives. Although the alert patients support the motives behind the strike, those who are unable to comprehend are suffering the most.
The aim of the WEA is twofold at the moment, I feel. Number one, to act as a university extension, and number two, to act as a leisure learning centre. It provides a wide range of courses, ranging from literature, arts and crafts, economics, philosophy, and weekend personal development courses.
And what sort of people are you catering for?
Well, again, we're catering for a very wide segment of the community, or very wide cross-section of the community, I should say, where people from almost every walk of life and every social section seem to come to the WEA because of their particular interest.
And the new term is just about to begin. Are there any courses which you think stand out this time?
Well, I particularly have an interest in pushing, I must admit, the Beyond the Economic Summit, or the economic summit and beyond, because I feel there must be a lot of people out there in the community who are conscious of the necessity to understand the economics of the nation, and this would provide them with a marvellous opportunity.
That a battle had been won dominated today's mass meeting, which began with a hero's welcome for the 14 miners who ended their historic 55-day sit-in in the Preston Extended Mine in Gunnedah. Their cause, to get their jobs back, has become a crucial part of the whole dispute surrounding the $150 million Drayton open cut and the expansion of Mount Thorley. The 4,100 miners who attended today's meeting heard from their officials reports on a long battle for state and federal government action on the mining industry's problems, culminating in a 10-point peace plan advanced yesterday by the state government. Amongst other things, the plan provides for a $4 a tonne job protection subsidy for the Gunnedah mines, reconstitution of the joint coal board with union representation, and an elaborate procedure for dealing with future retrenchments. It also places limits on overtime and on the future development of open-cut mines. In return, Drayton is to be allowed to open on a one-shift basis, and Mount Thorley to employ an additional 28 mine workers. When it came to the vote, the plan had little opposition from the mine workers. And in fact, the only heated discussion at the meeting centred on the fact that some open-cut miners had formed a breakaway group. The residual bitterness over the division of ranks may take some time to live down. But Miners' Federation President Bill Chapman says the government plan is a victory for the union movement.
I think that the 10 points, if accepted by all parties, will be a victory for the industry. It contains some innovations which have been sadly needed in this industry for many, many years. It's a great encouragement to us to see that the state government have acted the way they've acted. They've not only given the opportunity to salvage the industry in Gunnedah, they've set a platform that can bring about industrial peace in this industry.
However, the mine workers' acceptance of the government plan is not the whole story. For the Brayton project to begin, and for some peace in the troubled mining industry, the coal companies still have to endorse the plan, which they will not consider until Friday. Certainly till then, the future is still clouded.
Well, good morning, and 8 races at Hawkesbury today, with the first race getting underway at approximately 12:20. It's a pretty hard meeting, but the Foxes come up with the best bet of the day is in race 5. It's number 2, Fast Food. The Daily Double is conducted on races 5 and 7, and the Fox likes in the first leg number 2, Fast Food, and in the second leg number 1, Black Castle. Now, the Fox's trifecta is on race 7 tomorrow, and the numbers there, he likes 1, 7 and 5, Black Castle, to beat Duke Diamond, and number 5, Roic. Paul McNamee has won his first round in the 1983 Italian Open Championships. This is how he did it. The Bolivian player made some spectacular moves to return McNamee's trickier shots, but the Australian won in straight sets 6-4, 6-3. And this is a great backhand for a winner. McNamee serves again and shows his great agility around the court and his great reflexes to win this point. So Paul McNamee through the second round of the Italian Open. And now with a report on the under-18 women's basketball championships for the Newcastle Sports Entertainment Centre last night, here's Janelle Provost.
The most exciting game to date. That's how the clash between Victorian Country and Victoria Metropolitan in the National Under-18 Women's Basketball Championships has been described. It was a real grudge match, with both teams fighting for each point. Both teams made some good breaks, and the excellent defence ensured a neck-and-neck game. But on the night, Victoria Metro was the stronger team and beat their country cousins 56-51. In other games, Tasmania defeated the ACT 65-41, Western Australia were downed by Queensland 70-47, and South Australia beat New South Wales 59-50.
Thank you. Newcastle's goals all came in the opening half hour of play, beginning with a penalty converted by Mike Bogard within 30 seconds of the start. Newcastle's attack then recorded goals by halfback Grant Lee after 20 minutes and striker Bob Mountford after 30 minutes. For the remainder of the match, which was played in steady rain, Newcastle was content to sit on its lead. Because Newcastle's home ground was occupied by the Sydney versus Country Rugby League match, it had to be moved to suburban Adamstown for the game, but more than 3,000 fans turned up to cheer Newcastle, now leading the national competition for the first time.
This year's Wyong Cup meeting is now $10,000 richer thanks to the Westfield Group. At the Wyong track today, Westfield's marketing manager John Craig handed over a cheque for the $10,000 sponsorship to race club president George Clark.
It's the first major sponsorship that this club has had, and we feel very happy about it.
Not only will the Wyong races benefit from today's windfall, but work is still continuing on improvements to track and grandstand facilities. Two new training tracks have just been completed, one in grass, the other in sand. The southern grandstand is presently coming in for attention with the building of a new roof. That should also be completed well before August's big cup meeting. For Wyong racegoers, the future is indeed looking good.